Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio is Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. I would remind members that if they wish to seek to ask a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button or enter the letters RTS in the chat function during the relevant question. And at question number one, I call Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what feedback it has received from the arts and culture stakeholders following its announcement of the Scottish Budget 2024-25.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We're increasing funding to the culture and heritage sector by £15.8 million next financial year to £196.6 million. This is the first step on the route to investing at least £100 million more annually in culture and the arts by the financial year 28-29. In 2025-26, we aim to provide an additional £25 million to the culture sector, and this commitment to additional funding, despite the challenging budget situation, signals our confidence in the Scottish culture sector. The Board of Creative Scotland welcomed the proposed settlement for Creative Scotland of just over £68 million in grant and aid funding for 2024-25, which compares to £55 million for the current financial year, particularly given the continued pressure on the public finances. And I welcome views from other stakeholders as part of the Scottish Parliament budget process over the forthcoming weeks.
Sharon Dowie.
Thank you. The SNP Government claimed they increased culture funding by £15.8 million in the latest budget, but the Campaign for the Arts say that £13.2 million of that funding was restoring cuts. So cutting through the SNP spin, barely any of it was new money. Campaign for the Arts Director Jack Gamble said, amid a perfect storm, the Scottish Government needs to go much further, much faster, and it's nowhere near the £100 million extra for culture that the SNP pledged. Cabinet Secretary, is this just another broken promise? And what does the SNP have to say to disappointed businesses and organisations in the culture sector? Yeah.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would point her to the answer I just gave, which was the welcome of Creative Scotland for the increased funding that they're receiving. If the Scottish Conservative and Unionist Party has specific suggestions about additional funding that they believe the culture sector should require, I'd be very, very pleased to hear that from Sharon Dowie or from the front bench, and be pleased to hear from them where they would identify cuts elsewhere to make those additional commitments. This government has made commitments for increased spending. We're delivering it, and we're going to be delivering it more over the years ahead. And I would welcome the support of members and other parties in recognising that as a fact.
Question number two, Graeme Simpson.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the work of its overseas office.
Cabinet Secretary.
I was pleased last month to publish an annual report on the work of our overseas offices covering the period 2022 to 2023. This showed how Scotland's international network delivers crucial benefits to Scotland's people, to its businesses and institutions at home and abroad, and through international investment and growing our exports to facilitating cultural exchanges, promoting tourism, building our diaspora network, and we continue to enhance our international reputation across the world. Most recently, that included delivering a successful series of events to celebrate St. Andrew's Day and preparing a programme of events for Burns Night later this month. And I hope Graeme Simpson will join me in thanking all of our international network staff and global Scots and wishing them well for 2024.
Graeme Simpson.
Well, it's good to see the Cabinet Secretary here in Parliament today. I wonder if this year he's planning to beat his record of travelling to six countries in the first 7 months of last year, which cost £5,500. Now, the SNP government's overseas budget for their offices overseas is increasing to £7.8 million. And that is while budgets for transport, councils and housing are being slashed. So what's the return on that investment?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think that's a very good question, and I would point him to the report that I've already mentioned. I'm clearly, from the tone of the question, Graeme Simpson hasn't read it, because in it, it lists the benefits which are significant. Scottish Development International, for example, shows that this work is predicted to generate £1.7 billion of trade revenue. The report goes on to list 1,000 Scottish real living wage jobs through investments from the United States of America, 500 such jobs from Chinese investments, £120 million of planned capital investment through our presence in Canada, making 190 new connections for Scottish businesses through our Ireland office, and I could go on. I really would welcome some consistency from the Scottish Conservative Party in this, because from the front bench, we hear requests for us to increase our presence internationally, but from the backbenches, we are criticised. I make no apology to this chamber to promote Scotland internationally. I wish that members on his side of the chamber would welcome that.
Supplementary, Colin Beattie.
Can the Cabinet Secretary provide any updates regarding what assessments have been made as to the real benefits which Scotland's international network brings to our economy?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I repeat that I think the report that was published last month on the work of our overseas offices is extremely important, and I would recommend all members take the opportunity to read what it does. And I would want to pay tribute, and I'm sorry we didn't hear that from the Conservative benches, and they had the opportunity to do that, to welcome the hard work by those who work on our behalf, whether in Scottish Government offices, Scottish Development International offices, Global Scots Networks, our trade envoys. They are out there day in, day out, week in, week out, promoting Scotland, promoting our economy, promoting jobs, promoting tourism. We should get behind them rather than undermine them.
And supplementary, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Scotland's international offices are a great opportunity to connect Scotland with its diaspora and share Scotland's unique culture across the world. It also provides a unique opportunity to seek out funding and collaboration opportunities for projects here in Scotland. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, when the Scottish Government last reviewed the location of its international offices, and if it measures the availability of funding opportunities in comparison with countries where there is no international offices?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, may I commend Faisal Chowdhury, not just for the positive question that he asked there, and recognising the good work that goes on promoting Scotland, our economy, our culture, our tourism sector, but also the thoughtful query about the network itself in terms of where do we have offices, where do we have people in situ. This, incidentally, also being asked very positively in committee by the frontbench spokesperson for the Scottish Conservative Party. There are parts of the world that we don't yet have presence, and I do think it's worthwhile that we look at those. We are committed to maintaining the network as it currently exists. We are committed to opening a presence in Poland, which I think there's widespread agreement why that is as a good thing. But beyond that, questions have been raised about presence in South America by Donald Cameron, for example, or in Africa. No doubt Faisal Chowdhury, given his expertise in the region, would make a strong case for the Indian subcontinent, covering India, Bangladesh, Pakistan. I think this is very much worth looking at, and I would welcome the positive contribution by those who wish to promote Scotland internationally as opposed to those who want
to
undermine
it. I call question number three, Alistair Allen.
To ask the Scottish Government, as part of its work to further the case for Scottish independence, whether any of its future publications on independence will cover any constitutional lessons that can be learned from structures used in parliaments elsewhere that include unelected members.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
Set out in the paper Creating a Modern Constitution for an Independent Scotland. The written constitution in an independent Scotland will be founded on democracy, human rights and equality protections. We can learn many lessons from Westminster's House of Lords with its membership of over 800 unelected lifelong members, largely around practices we would seek to avoid in an independent Scotland. Only with independence can we ensure sovereignty rests with the people in Scotland. We have no plans for any unelected element in an independent Scotland's legislature.
Alistair Allen.
I thank the Minister for his reply. Will he agree that following Baroness Moan's disastrous television interview last month, the lesson that no Parliament should have an unelected House if it wishes to be accountable in any way whatsoever to the electorate is once more clearly, if rather painfully, made?
Minister. For matters within the Minister's responsibility.
I agree with that. I should, of course, say it's not just Ms Moan that has acted in a manner that is unbecoming of a person in public life as a member of the legislature of the UK. We've seen other issues with peers turning up to claim expenses just for the mere act of turning up at Westminster. But with respect to Ms Moan, we see serious questions, first of all, around the judgment of the Conservatives in sending her to the Lords in the first place. But around an individual who has used her own position as a member of the House of Lords at a time of international crisis, when we saw many people in all communities across Scotland freely volunteering their time to support their communities, seeking and not declaring an interest in using her position to rake in millions of pounds for her own family. That hardly speaks to a proper system of governance.
Sorry, thank you, Minister. I think we got the gist. The focus was on lessons to be learned from structures used in parliaments elsewhere that include unelected members. So I think we've kind of got the gist of that. And I call Donald Cameron.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And in reference to the question, which referenced future publications on independence, rather than committing to yet more papers on separation, which will inevitably end up out of date and in the political dustbin at a massive cost to the taxpayer, when will this government focus its efforts on dealing with the issues that people actually care about instead?
Minister.
Well, I would observe that this government, and remind Mr Cameron that this government has a mandate to pursue this work. We actually won the election, and this party lost the election, and there are many benefits to be gained by Scotland becoming an independent country. We'll continue to advance the case, and that will include the case where we shouldn't have a legislature with an unelected element, including minor nobility from Scotland as well. They'll have to seek to continue to be elected to this parliament.
Question number four, Marie McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on how it plans to further invest in the cultural sector.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As I've already confirmed to the Chamber, we are increasing funding to the culture sector by £15.8 million next financial year to £196.6 million. And that this is the first step on the route to investing at least £100 million more annually in culture and the arts by the financial year 28-29. A commitment's already been given by the Deputy First Minister in the recent budget that in 25-26 we aim to provide an additional £25 million to the culture sector. And this commitment to additional funding is despite the challenging budget situation, and it signals our confidence to the Scottish culture sector, including that in Clydebank and Milngavie.
Marie McNair.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer and welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to increase spending on culture. I've met with numerous arts and cultural groups within my local constituency, and these groups are so important as they not only create safe spaces to creative to thrive, but they also have meaningful connections to develop to reduce the social isolation that we face in our constituencies. What approach are the Scottish Government taking to ensure the additional investment will be shared fairly across all communities?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I start by paying tribute to Marie McNair, who has been a Doughty campaigner for the culture and arts community in Clydebank and Milngavie. And it's incredibly important that the benefits of funding for the culture and arts sector can be felt throughout the whole of the country. An example of that is the Culture Collective programme, which is a Scotland-wide programme that we fund developing grassroots participatory arts experiences in our communities, including projects to reduce social isolation. And through the increased investment in culture over the next 5 years, we want to drive up opportunities for participation in creative pursuits, and that, of course, includes that in Clydebank and Milngavie.
I have received requests for three supplementaries, and I intend to take all three. And firstly, supplementary from Alexandra Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Despite the SNP government, we would believe that the £6.6 million in the recent Scottish budget is increased funding. It's actually the reinstatement of Creative Scotland's 10% cut that was revealed a year ago, dropped in the spring, reinstated in September, and is now being disguised as an increase in investment. Therefore, Cabinet Secretary, following the announcement of £25 million for 25-26, how much of the funding is genuinely additional and will actually be delivered?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we're committed to delivering all of the funding, and I'm not sure whether that was a welcome for the increase. I didn't hear that. But I would hope that all of us, And I know the questioner is a strong supporter of culture and the arts. I know that from the role that he plays in committee. I think all of us need to row behind the culture and arts sector. We are wanting to provide the necessary funding. Yes, it's important that Creative Scotland has the funding that it requires. It is going to have that going forward. And I look forward to positive discussions, as I've offered to members across the Chamber and parties across the Chamber, any good ideas about how we can make sure that the culture and arts sector can thrive with the support of additional Scottish Government funding is going to be hugely welcome, and I welcome his participation as part of that process.
Supplementary, Willie Rennie.
I was pleased to hear the Cabinet Secretary in response to Mara McNair about every community benefiting from cultural spend, because the analysis of Events Scotland and Creative Scotland shows huge variations across the country. In Perth and Kinross, the spend is 3 times higher than in Fife. In Stirling, it's 4 times higher. Dundee, 6 times higher. Glasgow, 11 times higher. And then Edinburgh is 14 times higher than in Fife. So what is the Minister doing to make sure that every community benefits from this spend?
Cabinet Secretary.
Firstly, can I commend Willie Rennie, because he has asked this question a number of times, and he wants to ensure that the maximum possible spend for the culture and arts sector in North East Fife, but throughout Fife, the rest of Fife, can be secured. I've said to him previously that I think it's important that we have a separation between our arm's length culture organisation, Creative Scotland, who make these decisions, and ministers. It's not for ministers to direct specific regional projects. What I would say to him, though, is if he is aware of cultural projects that are not being appropriately funded, please make them make me aware of that. Please make Creative Scotland aware of that. I want to, and colleagues want to, make sure that our culture and arts sector right across Scotland is properly funded, and I'd welcome his input and extend the offer to him and his party colleagues about any suggestions that they may have about the increase in spending that we will be undertaking in the years ahead, where he thinks the relative priorities of those should be. I would welcome his input to that.
And supplementary, Mark Ruskell.
Despite £2 billion being spent on ticket sales across the UK, at least one grassroots music venue permanently closed their doors each and every week last year. Other countries have shown that there is a way out of this decline, with ticket levies supporting the development of grassroots music and venues. So does the Cabinet Secretary agree that in 2024 it's the year to turn this around, including by accelerating progress towards establishing a ticket levy on arena and stadium tickets to support the grassroots?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, well, I think the suggestion has been made, and the suggestion is being repeated now, and it's one that is being promoted very actively from some members of the cultural community, and the suggestion has been made that this needs to be explored further, and I'm open to learning about this. As I have said to the committee that Mark Ruskell serves on, that I think we need to look imaginatively at all kinds of ways in which we can secure the necessary funding to the culture and arts sector, and the suggestion that he has raised now a number of times is definitely one of those that merits further consideration. I look forward to the committee looking at that closely, to me receiving more advice on it, and then no doubt we will look at that together with other suggestions to ensure that the culture and arts sector receives the funding that it requires, that I know that he supports and that I certainly do.
Question number 5, not lodged. Question number 6, Finlay Carson.
To ask the Scottish Government how much is spent on the UCI World Cycling Championships in Glasgow in 2023.
Cabinet Secretary.
The total funding for the 2023 UCI Cycling World Championships is in the process of being finalised and will be confirmed in due course. It includes contributions from the Scottish Government, from UK Sport, from British Cycling, from Glasgow City Council and a number of other local authorities, as well as from commercial revenue streams. Any additional funding that may be required will be managed centrally by the Scottish Government.
Finlay Carson.
Thank you for the response. And I welcomed seeing the UCI in Scotland. Dumfries and Galloway played host to the road competitions for paracyclists, a region which has already etched its name in the history of cycling as the birthplace for the first pedal cycle bike in 1839. South of Scotland Destination Alliance suggested there might have been a £6 million boost to the local economy, but given the significant cost of hosting the event, including what we believe will be a significant overspend, what assessment has the Scottish Government made of the impact of that investment, and what work will it be doing with Dumfries and Galloway Council to ensure that they can deliver a long-term legacy?
Cabinet Secretary.
So first on process, the Scottish Government is meeting with 2023 Cycling World Championship Limited on a weekly basis to oversee the close down of contracts and achieve a final position on delivery costs, and we expect a final position by the end of the financial year. We also expect event evaluation information, which is, I think, goes to the heart of the question there, including economic benefit to Scotland, including the south of Scotland, and that will be published in February. And if I can take the opportunity, Presiding Officer, just to put on the record our thanks to the outgoing Chief Executive of the UCI World Championships, Trudy Lindblad, and wish her well as the new Chief Executive of Cricket Scotland.
Question number 7, Douglas Lumsden.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the total cost to date of its Building a New Scotland series of papers.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
The Scottish Government is publishing the publication costs of all the papers in the Building a New Scotland series. The Parliament has been informed of the cost for the first 9 papers in that series. The cumulative cost has been £151,657.40, meaning the average cost of the first 9 papers in the series of £16,850.21. This cumulative total represents a value of around 0.00025% of the total of the Scottish Government budget of this financial year. We'll continue to publish the cost information for future papers once released, as we committed to doing.
Dr. Sampson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So far, the SNP Government has wasted about £151,000 on 9 independence prospectus papers. What a complete waste of taxpayer money when the propaganda papers fail to answer any key questions about currency, fiscal framework and pensions. And even the First Minister previously described them as material that frankly sits on a website and nobody reads. Yeah. So, Minister, do you agree with the First Minister's comments? And can you explain to the Scottish taxpayers why this money would not be better spent on our schools, on our health service or on our police?
Minister.
Well, it's pretty clear that Mr Lumsden was looking for a figure that was rather higher than a value of around 0.00025% of the total of the Scottish Government's budget this financial year. He clearly wasn't listening when I responded to Mr Cameron. I'll need to remind Mr Lumsden, we won the last Scottish Parliament election. We have a mandate to take forward this activity, as Parliament lost the last Scottish Parliament election. That's why we are in government. And I think it is money well spent when you look at countries around Scotland, like Scotland, with Ireland, with an income per head of 24% higher than the UK, Denmark 35% higher than the UK, Norway 61% higher than the UK, when we have a bourich of a UK economy, the OBR predicting as a result of Brexit we'll have GDP 4% lower in the long run. The only way we can escape this mess is through independence, and we'll continue to make the case.
Supplementary, Jackie Dunbar.
To ask the Minister if he could provide an update on how the United Kingdom's GDP per capita compares to that of the comparator countries used in the Building a New Scotland series of papers.
Well, indeed.
Minister, that's a bit wide of the question on the business bulletin, I'm afraid, because we're looking at an update on the total cost of the actual papers, not the substance, and I'm afraid I think it's a bit wide in the incident case. Supplementary, Neil Bibby.
Having previously urged the Scottish Government to build a clear and credible independence strategy, former SNP Minister Alex Neil now says that, in the view of many independence supporters, the SNP, and I quote, has abandoned any pretence of trying to get independence anytime soon. How does the Scottish Government justify the costs involved in these white papers and hope to build a consensus around its independence strategy as set out in the white papers when it can't achieve that consensus within its own party?
Minister.
Well, I have to say, not for the first time I disagree with Mr Neil. I believe we are building a credible and compelling case for independence, and I've already made the point about the advantages that other countries similar to Scotland have as a consequence of independence, and I would have thought where the Labour Party might have agreed at a time when we have the Joseph Rowntree Foundation saying destitution is on the increase in the UK, but be mitigated by the Scottish Government here, when we have the Resolution Foundation pointing out that if the UK had the average income and levels of inequality of similar countries, typical households would be £8,300 better off. That rises to £10,200 when you compare us to countries similar to Scotland. He would, and the Labour Party and other members, will be able to see the benefits of independence, and that's the case we'll continue to make.
And question number eight, Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the reopening of Historic Environment Scotland sites following the completion of work to make them safe for the public, including when the remaining sites will reopen.
Minister Christina McKelvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to say that Historic Environment Scotland's inspection programme concludes at the end of March 2024. Once completed, Historic Environment Scotland will have a clearer indication on the extent of the scale of the challenge and the resources required to carry out conservation works. There is now full or partial access to 53 of the 70 sites that had access restricted due to high-level masonry issues. And I am pleased that Historic Environment Scotland continues to put the health and safety of individuals first, reopening sites only when it's safe to do so. And details of the inspection programme and site reopenings are all published on the Historic Environment Scotland's website.
Alexander Burnett.
Thank the Minister for that answer, and specifically in my constituency, Colgarth Castle, which played an important role in the Jacobite risings, closed at the height of summer last year due to staffing issues. According to Historic Environment Scotland, this issue affected a number of sites, particularly in rural areas. Now, the Cabinet Secretary asked earlier for examples which he would support, so can the Minister guarantee but sites like Colgarth Castle and others in rural areas will not be affected by this issue this summer?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I take into account the issue that Alexander Burnett's raising, particularly in his area, around about staffing and staffing in rural areas. I have to say Brexit is the biggest driver of the lack of that staffing in rural areas, and I think we should take that into account. When it comes to the reopening or the opening of these facilities and historic environment properties, I would tell the member that Historic Environment Scotland publish all of the updates on their website. It's easily found by anyone, but I would be happy to make sure Historic Environment Scotland updates Alexander Burnett on the issues affecting his particular case. And Historic Environment Scotland have, on a number of occasions, offered individual members visits to those sites to talk through some of the issues, and I would urge Alexander Burnett to take up that offer.
Thank you, Minister. And that concludes portfolio questions on Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. And we will now move on to the next portfolio, which is, if people are wishing to move to the front bench, they should please do so. Otherwise, stay where they are. And we will move on to the next portfolio, which is Justice and Home Affairs. And at question number one, I call Ariane Burgess.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether GeoAmey, the prison escort service provider, has offered any assurances that it will tackle the reported staffing challenges that currently mean that islanders acting as witnesses have to travel to jury trials on the mainland.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, we have been supporting the Scottish Prison Service and other partners in delivering an improvement in the GeoAmey contract, which has resulted in early positive signs with a slowdown in staff attrition and improved staff numbers. Following the pausing of the post-pandemic reintroduction of solemn jury trials to the Sheriff Courts at Lerwick, Kirkwall, Portree, Stornoway, Lochmaddy and Wick, assurances have been given by GeoAmey that they will be able to properly resource the courts from spring 2024.
Ariane Burgess.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. According to a recent audit of the contract, the ongoing poor performance of GeoAmey is resulting in delays and inefficiencies across the justice sector, impacting on policing, prison services and the courts, and is now requiring direct funding from government. Can the government confirm, in the light of this, there is no question of extending their contract for a further 4 years, as permitted, and that GeoAmey's record will be taken into consideration during future bids for lucrative government contracts?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, there's no doubt about it that the performance of GeoAmey has been utterly unacceptable and has had huge impacts across the justice system. The Criminal Justice Board has been engaged on issues relating to the contract, and as stated by Theresa Medhurst, the Scottish Prison Service Chief Executive at the Criminal Justice Committee last month, all options remain under consideration in relation to prisoner escort arrangements in Scotland. The performance of GeoAmey will definitely be a vital factor to be considered while deciding on the future model of prisoner transport service contract. And SPS is continuing to monitor the performance of the contract carefully to ensure targeted thresholds are met and that we see an appropriate level of service which meets the needs of the Scottish justice system.
Supplementary, Liam McArthur.
Thank you. The Justice Secretary will know from our correspondence back in the summer about my concerns about the impact that the loss of sheriff jury trials in the islands and rural courts is having on access, local access to justice. I welcome the fact that these will be resuming from spring, although that is longer than I think anyone would have liked. Can the Cabinet Secretary offer a reassurance that the changes to the contract with GeoAmey will ensure that rural and island courts are not seen as the expendable end of the justice system going forward?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, Mr McArthur and I have indeed extended or exchanged correspondence extensively on this matter. I have it here with me today. I should say to him that we are seeing some promising early signs. For example, in terms of police custody officers, we have had an increase of 40 in the past 3 months. There's a number of officers currently in training. There are lower levels of staff attrition, which is down by 40%. But nonetheless, you know, we need to closely monitor the situation. And the point that he makes about the Highlands and the island communities in particular is well made. There have been particular issues in rural Scotland, but also in other areas of Scotland that we're particularly focused on.
Question number two, Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what protection is available to victims of domestic abuse when harassment and exclusion orders expire.
Minister Siobhan Bryan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A non-harassment order can be made in certain circumstances by a criminal court or by a civil court. The criminal and civil court can make a non-harassment order that runs for an indefinite period if it considers it appropriate. A person can apply for an exclusion order from a civil court to exclude their spouse or civil partner, or in certain circumstances, their cohabiting partner from the family home. These orders end automatically in certain circumstances, such as when a couple divorces. Anyone who remains at risk of abuse or harassment after an exclusion order or a non-harassment order ends could apply to the civil courts for a further non-harassment order or an interdict.
Oliver Mundell.
I thank the Minister for that answer, but that's not been the experience of a constituent of mine who struggled to get legal representation and navigate the court process. More needs to be done, so I would be keen to understand from the Minister when domestic abuse protection orders will be implemented by this Scottish Government, and if the Minister agrees with me that a 2-year-plus delay in getting this additional measure in place sends the wrong message to victims.
Minister.
I thank the member for his question. The non-harassment orders are intended to provide a means of ensuring that ongoing harassment can be prevented. They can be especially important protecting victims from ongoing abuse by a partner or ex-partner convicted of domestic abuse offence, particularly those long-term coercive or controlling behaviours. However, discretion lies with the court in each individual case to determine whether to impose an NHO.
And supplementary, Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Women continue to struggle to get legal support in Shetland for domestic abuse cases, including harassment and exclusion orders. They're required, sometimes with great urgency, to find and engage a solicitor on the Scottish mainland who will take on legal aid cases. Does the Scottish Government agree that this situation is unacceptable, with island victims of domestic abuse facing unique barriers to justice at often critical and vulnerable times?
Minister.
Thank you. Our current legal aid funding arrangement ensures that around 70% of people are eligible for a form of civil legal aid in Scotland. Means testing remains important lever to ensure that we retain the wide scope of cases which legal aid is available in principle. We've also invested significant levels of funding in frontline services, as well as working closely with statutory agencies to improve their response to victims and survivors. And we also provide support to Scottish Women's Rights Centre.
Question number three, Neil Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on the proposed closures of Paisley, Fergusley Park, Greenock, Bishop Briggs and Mulgaie police stations.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, through the delivery of its estate strategy, Police Scotland is putting plans in place to modernise its estate to make it fit for purpose. We are supportive of plans to co-locate with other parts of the public sector, including local authorities, which promotes closer working and collaboration, delivering better outcomes for individuals and communities. And I agree with the Deputy Chief Constable, Malcolm Graham, when he said that the presence of policing in communities, and I quote, is not defined by buildings, but by the officers and staff who work in our communities. And I would encourage anyone with an interest to respond to the consultation, which is available on the Police Scotland website.
Neil Bibby.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. And it's important the Scottish Government does not wash its hands of this and say that it's just an operational matter, when my constituents in Paisley Green at Fergusley Park, Mulgaye and Bishop Briggs are extremely concerned about the possible closures of their local police stations. What financial support will the Government provide to protect local stations if police and public deem them necessary? And where police have indicated they support a replacement presence, for example in Paisley and in Greenock, where they are located in town centres, are 24 hours, have CID, and in Greenock's case have a custody suite, does the Cabinet Secretary agree that any replacements should be done on a like-for-like basis?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I certainly recognise that in some instances people feel very strongly about the police estate and police buildings in their local communities, hence the purpose of the consultation. But it is crucial that as we move forward that we do have a modern fit-for-purpose facilities, and bearing in mind that police officers tend to be more mobile in their work. In terms of Mr Bibby's locality, it is important to recognise that there is a consultation, that Police Scotland are in discussions around co-location with Renfrewshire Council, and also about identifying appropriate community engagement facilities. But this is about co-location to enhance the effectiveness of policing, to enhance local partnership working, and to also improve the visibility and presence of policing in our communities.
And supplementary, Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As the Cabinet Secretary says, Police Scotland has said properties that have been selected for potential disposal under the Services Estate Strategy form part of moves towards co-location with partners where possible to ensure services are delivered in the most efficient and effective way. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide further detail of the success that has already been had with co-location?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I think we're all agreed that we all want our public services to be effective and to be efficient. Co-location with suitable partners makes best use of the public sector estate and importantly offers the opportunity for increased visibility and closer working. There are over 60 examples of successful co-location across the Police Scotland estate. That's around 20% of its estate. 13 of those co-locations are blue light collaborations. There's a great example in my own constituency in West Lothian, but there are also other examples with co-location in Alloa, with Clackmannanshire Council, in Aberdeen City Council and Inverness, where there is a co-location with the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service as well. And it's also important to recognise that the Criminal Justice Committee in its pre-budget scrutiny report at the end of last year said that in police and fire service services, we should explore the provision of newer co-located premises which offer improved facilities for officers and staff.
Call question number 5, Colin Smith, who's joining us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the potential impact that the Scottish Budget 2024-25 will have on police officer numbers in the South Scotland region.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, as outlined in the recent budget, we will increase the Scottish Police Authority resource budget by £75.7 million in 2024-25. While it is for the Chief Constable to decide how best to deploy police resources, I welcome her statement to the Criminal Justice Committee on the 20th of December that the budget settlement would allow recruitment of officers to restart before the end of this financial year. Police Scotland has recruited almost 600 officers in 2023 and around 1,480 new recruits since the beginning of 2022. And at the 30th of September, there were 379 more police officers than in 2007. And of course, Scotland has more police officers per capita than England and Wales and higher pay ranges, with 30 officers per 10,000 of the population compared to 25 in England and Wales.
Colin Smith.
Officer, we've seen police officer numbers plummet right across Scotland in recent years. In the smallest division, Dumfries and Galloway, numbers have been cut from 411 in June 2020 to just 354, which means at certain times you have just a couple of officers covering a huge geographical area. So can the Cabinet Secretary confirm whether the recent budget will mean we will return to the levels of June 2020 in Dumfries and Galloway? And given that the SNP commitment to maintain police numbers at the level when Police Scotland was established a decade ago now seems dead in the water, just what exactly is the government's current specific target for officer numbers?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, of course, the establishment agreement of officer number is an operational matter for the Chief Constable. The Chief Constable, when she appeared at the Criminal Justice Committee just before Christmas, made very clear that when she was welcoming the budget settlement, and that will enable Police Scotland to retain police numbers of around 16,500 or 16,600. It is important to remember that we now have nearly 400 more officers now than we did in 2006-07. And in terms of the Dumfries and Galloway divisional area, as of 30th of September 2023, there were 354 officers. This compares to 349 30th September the year before. This is a small increase, and I would hope give some reassurance to Mr Smith about the stabilisation of police resources in his area.
Supplementary, Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I met with the Divisional Commander of Dumfries and Galloway just before recess, and he welcomed that we do have additional recruits in the region, however noted that rurality does pose huge challenges with appropriate officer cover. Can the Cabinet Secretary comment on whether Dumfries and Galloway could be considered a priority area for police recruitment, given the challenges of rurality and officer coverage after the end of the current recruitment freeze?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, it is important to recognise that there are particular challenges for particular workforces in rural Scotland, and that's why Police Scotland have undertaken targeted recruitment. There was certainly targeted recruitment last year in Stranraer and Dumfries, and as I hope that I've demonstrated with the numbers that I quoted to Mr Smith, that there has been a small increase and a stabilisation of police numbers across the Dumfries and Galloway divisional area. It should be noted that the creation of a Scottish-wide single police service means that all communities have greater access to national policing capabilities than would otherwise be the case. And of course, local area commanders can also draw on specialist resources to support local policing wherever they are needed.
Supplementary, Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The latest recorded crime statistics from Police Scotland show that in the Ayrshire Police Division, overall crime jumped by more than 10% at a time when police numbers have fallen in Ayrshire since the SNP centralised their police forces. Cabinet Secretary, how much more do you think crime should rise in communities like Ayrshire before you start properly resourcing our police?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, for this current financial year, resourcing for policing across Scotland benefited by an additional £80 million. We just introduced the draft Scottish Budget before Christmas, which once again seen additional resource and capital for Police Scotland. And it is important that we recognise that there continues to be more police officers per capita in Scotland than in comparison to England and Wales. And Scotland is now a safer place because recorded crime has reduced by 41% since 2006-07. So Scotland, under the SNP, is indeed a safer place.
Question number six, Gordon MacDonald.
to ask the Scottish Government how its budget for 2024-25 will support Police Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, protecting frontline services and supporting those who deliver them is a key priority for the Scottish Government. That is why, despite deeply challenging financial circumstances, the 2024-25 Scottish Budget provides record funding for the Scottish Police Authority and Police Scotland. We will invest £1.55 billion in policing in the next financial year. The police resource budget will be increased by £75.7 million, a 5.6% increase, with the capital budget increasing to £64.6 million, representing a 12.5% increase compared to the 2023-24 budgets.
Gordon MacDonald.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and I also welcome the real terms budget increase for Police Scotland. However, with the continued squeeze on Barnet consequentials and the disappointing autumn statement, can the Cabinet Secretary outline what impact this will have on delivering a fit-for-purpose Police Scotland service in the long term?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, last month's autumn statement was, of course, the worst-case scenario for Scotland, containing a fiscal settlement from the UK Government that undermined the viability of public services across the whole of the UK, including here in Scotland. And our block grant funding for this budget has fallen by 1.2% in real terms since 2022-23, and our capital spending power is due to contract by almost 10% in real terms over the next 5 years. Nonetheless, protecting frontline services it is a priority for the Scottish Government, and nonetheless our budget is delivering for justice and is delivering for policing in particular. And as I perhaps it's helpful if I quote to Chamber the Chief Constable, when she attended committee and welcomed the budget settlement, said that this budget settlement was in recognition of Police Scotland's value and contribution that policing makes to Scotland being a safe place to live and work with historically low levels of crime. And I'm very pleased to commend a budget to Parliament that, when you consider both resource and capital, has an increased investment of £92.7 million in policing for Scotland.
And supplementary, Ross Finlay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Every single police officer in the UK has body-worn cameras, apart from here in Scotland. They protect police officers and the public, they support victims and witnesses, they save time and money. Hamza Yousaf has repeatedly promised them, yet due entirely to SNP budget choices, Scotland has been left behind. 3 weeks ago, the day after the budget, I asked the new Chief Constable if the 2027 target date for full delivery would be met, but she could not tell me. So when exactly will our officers finally get this basic kit?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, I would have hoped that Mr Finlay would have welcomed two facts. One, that the rollout of body-worn cameras for police officers will indeed commence this coming calendar year. And I also would have thought that he would have welcomed the record investment in policing in Scotland. And surely that's good news that we can all celebrate.
Question number seven, Faisal Chaudhry.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the potential impact of the proposed closure of 29 police stations across Scotland and antisocial behaviour.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the deployment of police resources and operational matters are, of course, decisions for the Chief Constable. The Scottish Government has increased police funding to Police Scotland year on year since 2016-17, with £1.55 billion being committed in the 2024-25 budget. We fully support Police Scotland and local authorities who lead on responding to antisocial behaviour, and we continue to encourage early intervention, diversion and appropriate support through multi-agency partnership approaches.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Police Scotland have confirmed that there has been a recent rise of antisocial behaviour in Linlithgow. While often non-criminal and the impact it has on the local community is undeniable. Linlithgow lost their police station a number of years ago, and constituents are concerned that the lack of police presence is contributing to young people engaging in such behaviour. What specific action is the Scottish Government taking to ensure communities where police stations are earmarked for closure continue to feel the safe and protected in their local area?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, Mr Chowdhury might be aware that the police station in Linlithgow has been vacant for more than 6 years and therefore it has been declared surplus by Police Scotland. In terms of antisocial behaviour, he may be aware that the Minister, Ms Brown, has established a working group on antisocial behaviour which brings experts and practitioners together to examine our strategic approach to antisocial behaviour and proposed improvements, and that group will report later on this year. It is appropriate, I think, that after 20 years of the existing antisocial behaviour legislation that we are due for a timely review, and I look forward to all members' contributions to that.
And question number 8, Colin Beattie.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it and its partners are taking to tackle retail crime and its potential impact on communities in the light of the reported increase in retail crime caused by the cost of living crisis.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government recognises the significant disruption and harm to both businesses and to individuals from retail crime and continues to support the innovative Scottish Partnership Against Acquisitive Crime, also known as SPACE strategy. The partnership is led by Police Scotland, working with retailers and other organisations, including Retailers Against Crime and Neighbourhood Watch Scotland, with a focus on the prevention, deterrence and, where appropriate, enforcement. The strategy seeks to minimise opportunities for this type of crime, protect individuals and businesses, and deliver clear advice and guidance for prevention. And I would urge all retailers to continue to engage with Police Scotland and other partners to help safeguard their businesses and the people that work there.
Colin Beattie.
In my constituency of Midlothian North and Musselburgh, there has been continued and escalating incidents of retail crime, resulting not only to a threat to the livelihoods of small business owners, but also an unacceptable threat to staff's physical safety while at their place of work. Can the Minister advise what additional support is being put in place to ensure the safety and security of both staff and property for retailers and to ensure that there is effective deterrent and punishment for criminals who take part in retail crime?
Minister.
Thank you. We recognise the vital role of retail workers in our society and we want to ensure that they are protected. Workers across all sectors should be safe at work and should never have to experience abuse or violence when simply doing their job. The Protection of Retail Workers Scotland Act, which came into force in August 2021, created a statutory offence of threatening, abusing or assaulting a retail worker, ensuring that the seriousness of this behaviour is highlighted through a specific offence. There have been 543 charges under the Act that have received a conviction in criminal court from August 2021 to March 2023. While there has been a long-term reduction in levels of recorded non-sexual violence, 25% between 2006 to 2007 and from 2022 to 2023, along with its partners, the Scottish Government is continuing to implement the violence prevention framework, and this is backed with £2 million worth of investment this year to fund a range of activities to help prevent and divert people away from violence.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on Justice and Home Affairs, and there will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow front bench teams to change position should they so wish. Thank you.